Life had just begun, but now I've gone and thrown it all away.
The most precious thing we have on this planet is time. Life's too short for software.
We are the future. We are all data nerds.
With product, because I want to ask a couple sort of revenue-related questions on product. Sure. So my first exposure to New Relic back in the day at EchoSign is my CTO came to me and said, we're using New Relic now. Where the hell was this product, right? We'd built our own hacked system before for APM or what we call it today. And he was in love, and I think, I'm sure you can tell me the NPS of New Relic's very high, and people love, we know this stuff, right? Yeah. But everyone loves their product, right? And there's a million great products out there. And you can build great software and never be a huge success. So what is the real secret sauce for New Relic? Why did it become a success fairly quickly, right? I know there were a few bumps. We talked about Lehman Brothers in 08 and 09.
Yeah.
But it was a fairly fast path to success. If we ignore the peaks and valleys, we'll talk about what was really the secret sauce.
Well, life is, I think the best blessing was I had a chance at a do-over, right?
Do-over, yeah.
You know, my first company was kind of like the learning experience of creating a new category, inventing something that we thought solved the problem, but learning along the way what the problem really was and who the user was and what they needed. And along the way, we built a nice company, but there were flaws in the business model, which are the flaws we know about traditional big ticket on-premise enterprise software and the heavy go-to-market model. So I've loved building software since 1982, and it was only after I sold my first company that I realized as a builder of software, it was really my fault on the product side for building a product that said yes to everyone for every request.
Yeah.
And
just a quick for the guess, your company before that was Wiley, and it was sold for $400 million or $300 million, right?
Yeah, Wiley Technology.
By any absolute sense, a huge success, right? If we ignore all the trials and tribulations getting there, right?
No regrets, but it was a wonderful prototype.
And you said yes to everything, right?
So we had this product that we could solve lots of problems, but you know, Jay, just masterful, talking about how whatever you can build in software to reduce the human effort in getting the customer to a delightful state,
yeah,
you know, immeasurable value to your business model, but also it's a better customer experience. So let me paint the picture of the founding months of New Relic, or the period of time when the idea of New Relic came to mind. It was the summer of 07, and the iPhone first came out.
Yeah.
First iPhone. And I got it, like everyone, or many people in this room probably did, pretty shortly after the launch. And what stunned me was Apple put so much R&D into the first minute of experience with the product.
Yeah.
You know, so I've used my iPhone for years. But the minute, you know, the unboxing and the self-activation of the phone, the fact that somebody at the Sprint or AT&T store in the past activated your phone, put all the stuff in so you could use the product, right? And Apple said, no, we're going to put a lot of software design and engineering effort into that first minute because it's the most important minute.
Yeah.
And I thought, that's missing in enterprise software. People think about how's the software going to behave after the months of consulting services to get it working. What that does is it disempowers your customer, and it dramatically increases your cost of customer acquisition.
Yeah.
So I put a lot of time thinking about that, like what's that unboxing-like experience of discovering New Relic? And because that's when a prospect is not so sure about you as a vendor, they're like, oh, you know, New Relic, funny-sounding name, oxymoronic, what do they do? I don't know. You know, you've got 60 seconds, maybe, you know, 180 seconds to impress me. The timer starts as soon as you sign up.
Yeah.
How do we wow the customer then? So that was super important, and I feel like it's part of the success.
Yeah. And how are you, since we went back to the early days, So you see the iPhone, you have the Wiley experience, you want to have an amazing user experience from day one. You want to bring the iPhone to the enterprise, which I think today we all get, but back then was a little bit more innovative, right?
Thanks to your publications, we now all understand.
We all get it. How did you get it? I mean, you were a second-time founder, but how did you get New Relic really going? How did you get the first 100 customers or 200? What was the hack that got it off the ground?
I mean, it was... You know, not having the benefit of the collective wisdom that's in this room today, I mean, this was mostly landed on, you know, learning from my first one, as I said. And so how we got the thing going was, you know, how lots of companies get started. I started this with a prototype. Actually, New Relic started as my Teach Myself Ruby on Rails project. I still love to
write. I remember reading that. Yeah, all right.
So I learned this language, Ruby, and one of the things about Ruby that's kind of interesting is how easily hackable the code is, and so there's part of me that says, wow, I could build a, you know, the equivalent of the Wiley agent, a far better one, far faster.
That's a classic Ruby story right
there. And so that was my little Teach Myself Ruby project, because I was looking for things to do on my sabbatical. And then I showed up people like, wow, we could really use this. And I was like, well, maybe I'll do the base camp thing and self-fund a little lifestyle business.
Yeah.
Not to in any way disparage that. I mean, like, a great lifestyle business. But the idea was just, how far can I go with this little idea? And it turns out that it had the potential to be much larger, and it made sense to attract venture funding. But I found a way to connect with thought leaders in the Rails community. And one of the things that I think is super important is early on picking the right size of market segment to focus on so you can own it.
Yeah.
Right? Ruby on Rails performance marketing. It certainly wasn't market size that attracted Benchmark to that deal, because it's a great market, but it's not a large market. But we could own it. And the way we owned it was we reached out to the thought leaders in that community, and we got them to try it. So on the day we launched, we had references from the likes of Basecamp, 37 Signals at the time, and a few other Rails core committers. And we had a partnership with a big Rails hosting company at the time that brought our product to 400 customers day one.
Mm, got it.
You got to be thoughtful about how you launch. It can't just be product.
So hyper focus on Ruby and Rails and direct outreach to enough folks to get those first 10, 100
get those thought leaders, and Twitter was in its infancy, but all those people are on Twitter, so like you got this wonderful, you know, the best marketing, of course, is when thought leaders are talking about your product on your behalf.
Did you know to go for it and do a non-lifestyle business at that point, or when was it after that, or when was that moment when?
So Peter Fenton at Benchmark he's a dear friend. I was his first venture deal in 2001, so we go way back.
Got it.
And he has a remarkable wine collection.
The best, it turns out.
Well, he has a remarkable wine collection, and I remember having a spectacular glass of wine in 2008 where we thought about whether we should work again together again. He said, if we're going to do this, let's build a great company together with no regrets. And let's see how, you know, not just, you know, obviously that implies being big and having an impact and growth and revenues and all that, but like somewhere we love the journey and there's nothing we'd rather do than be engaged in this business. And he's remarkably persuasive, and he was true. So that was what we decided to try to do. Yep. And it's kind of fueled how I thought about New Relic along the way, is like, let's never regret a Monday doing this thing. And that drives why we like to deliver our product to more customers, to more end users, and deliver more amazing products that, you know, do the bulk of the selling. And I know this is probably part of what you want to talk about, but what's the role of product versus sales professional in the process is super important to think about when you build your business.
Yeah. So let's dig in there for a minute since you brought it up. So New Relic launches, it's a freemium product, right? Mm-hmm. It's going to be huge, but it's freemium. And we'd all love...
Jury was out on how huge it was going to be.
What's that?
Jury was definitely out early days. I mean,
well, we all hoped that freemium would scale infinitely back in the day, right?
Yes.
You call 07, 06, we just, it seemed like freemium was this magic, and sometimes it is.
Yep.
And then what were the learnings? Where did you see, was it just going up market, or did you just see a ceiling to that early, or what?
We learned a lot, and you know, you learn a lot by just engaging in the market. So the first time we launched, in June of 08, no free tier. And we had those first 300 or 400 customers through a partnership, and then they were trickling in one or two at a time thereafter.
Yeah.
Because we just thought the product would just attract customers, and that's surprising for a second time founder. But I was like, how far can we push this with the leanest?
And what did New Relic cost then if you bought it off the website?
Surprisingly similar to today. I think that point, no, we had like $80 to $100 a server or a host, I think was the price point back then, but it was a much lesser functionality. We hadn't developed some killer features that we knew the market would value.
Got it.
We were moving really fast, so we had another major launch 3 months later where we had all these new features that could differentiate the tiers, go out at $200 a month per server. And I remember my chief product officer and me just saying, what should we do about free? And we decided to go for it and try it. And that had immense impact on our top line. So when we launched the higher end product, we also launched Lite in September of 08. And then, you know, the chart had one of its first, you know, these are all bursties, but it had a nice period of time where sales really started to come in, driven off the awareness that Lite brought to the market.
And then when did you come to the conclusion that adding sales people would accelerate that versus take away from it?
Yeah.
And it's something we all struggle with, and the more sort of developer product focused you are, the more sometimes folks wrestle with this question.
Sure, it is. Right? It's a great question. And I feel like the history of a company has been, how far can you take it to the extreme to see how far you can go with a certain thing, learn from it, and then sort of, you know, feather in things that can help accelerate your business that come with a structural operating cost, like sales.
Yeah.
I'll talk about support as another example. So we went throughout all of 2008 without a sales rep. And we got pretty far. And then again, Peter Fenton, I think he was the only board member in most of 2008, he said, well, who actually talks to your customers? I'm like, geez. You know, that's a pretty good question that I should have the answer to. And because we didn't have someone full-time talking to customers.
Even just on success, customers, what we call customer success.
Yeah, of course. We had people answer the phone, but nobody... Yeah. Nobody really fully tasked with that in a very small, lean Series A company. But we decided to experiment with, like, what would happen if we had someone calling out to prospects, calling out to free trials and things like that, and trying to convert them. And lo and behold, they converted better. Because it turns out that even with an amazing product that people love, our customers are super busy, and there's always a reason for them to defer that purchase or subscription decision to next week.
Yes.
And so we have to offer our customers a reason to, you know, prioritize the decision now, in order to, and it had an immense impact on sales. So we started to build out that inside sales force starting in 2009.
Yeah. Just for fun, because we had Jay before.
Yeah.
To put words in his mouth, which might be the wrong words, he might say, well, that's great, Lew. You put the salespeople, you pulled the revenue forward, but so what? You'd get the customer anyway. And I'm going to get them for 10 years, so it doesn't matter. Is your experience? I think what you learned is if you pull it forward, you close more of the customers, right?
That's been our experience, and it really varies by product and market.
Very,
and I think Atlassian is a remarkable story of how they've been able to do it without the sales function. But in our case, we wanted a model that was affordable for smaller companies, but scaled very nicely with large companies. And so, and we do have a very nice, like, tiered customer base where we've got well over 25% of the Fortune 100 and many, million dollar a year subscribers.
Yeah.
But we also have an awful lot of $200 or $100 a month customers. The sales function was essential to kind of driving people into those higher tiers. But what I liked about the New Relic model that was a departure from the previous one is you could get started at a reasonable price point because we the product was so self-explanatory and easy to use compared to the others in our space. And believe me, the systems management is not known for easy to use, delightful software. So, you know, we kind of had an opportunity to really differentiate there. And we did. And so the sales team was really about getting people who already tried and liked our product to make a commitment to be a customer and then grow them as customers.
Yeah. And New Relic has, I would describe it as relatively sales efficient, right? Certainly compared to a lot of companies out there. Mm-hmm. How did you think about that? Did you manage to any of these goals in terms of CAC and magic numbers and ratio? Did you say we'll spend this much on sales, but we don't want to impact the bottom line too much? Or is there a way you hacked or backed into that? Because I'd say New Relic's kind of this middle path between blowing it all on the team, right?
Yep.
And spending none.
We've never thought of ourselves as a growth at all costs company.
Sorry, say that again.
A growth at all costs company.
Yes.
And I feel like there were several of those, you know, in prominent places 2 years ago, and that's obviously the tide is turning a bit on sentiment around that. My CFO Mark and I have worked together since 99, two companies now, and we always wanted to have good control over the business. We raised money after 9/11. We raised money on the crash of 2008. We've seen it all. This is walk in the park.
Your blood brothers or something like that.
This is just so easy compared to what we've seen going on right now. And so we always wanted complete control of the business. That's why we landed on the SaaS model. We wanted very predictable revenues. We didn't want to be beholden to one or two customers. So at Relic, no customers more than 2% of our subscription base. And there's a variety of ways we did a CAC LTV and things like that, but one of our gut checks was always periodically, I'd check in with Mark and say, if we froze hiring today, how many days until cash flow? Even in Series A, Series B timeframe.
Yeah.
So what if the market fell apart today and there was just no sources of funding?
Yeah.
Would we have to have layoffs?
Only those of us that live through those moments in time do that
exercise. Right. And it was always 90 days or less.
Yeah.
So we could freeze hiring.
Yeah.
Keep the investment where it's at, and then within 90 days,
there's enough growth you'd catch up to it.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. And so, there are various ways we do it today. It's a little different. We're at a different level of scale, but now we just generated our first cash flow positive quarter last week.
Yeah.
It's always been a business we've had under control, and a big knob in that is sales and marketing investment, obviously.
Yeah.
It's by design.
And tell me a little bit, because I want to learn more about. Talk about the journey as you go from something that's still very much an engineering and developer-focused product, but consumed by more and more people in the company and the enterprise. What are the, because some of that, a lot of that's not obvious, right? And some people overstate that happens, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, how many of your customers are CMOs directly? But you have a much larger footprint in companies. So what are the learnings and what happens here over time?
This has certainly been a journey that I started back in Wiley, where I remember in 2002-03, we're like, all right, we have this agent observing everything in software.
Yeah.
And just think what goes on in software. Every time you deposit a check, that's flowing through software. Every time you purchase something online, that's flowing through software. That data has to be valuable to more than just the people that debug the software. So this has been a problem I've noodled on for well over a decade. And yet, of course, we want to stay true to this incredibly, the developer community, they create massive market technology standards. The developer community created the standardizations that are AWS and MySQL and Linux. It wasn't a top-down CIO dictum that says we're standardizing on Linux in 99.
Yes, that's for sure.
Right? It's an army of grassroots developers that find something that's better and then inevitably work their way in the enterprise. So we want them as a key constituent. They're a hard crowd to please, and if you please them, you know your competitors are going to struggle to try to migrate over there.
Yeah.
But then there's the IT ops team. And they're a super important constituent to us as well, because if you're going to standardize across a large enterprise, central IT has to be involved, super involved, and they're often driving that decision. So whereas New Relic a couple of years ago was doing great on digital and departmental deals, and showing success in the modern customer-facing projects that are driving the top line, you know, now we're standardizing, like we just announced last week, we're global standard at General Electric now. And that involves engaging with IT.
And but they're looking for something different out of New Relic, right?
Well, they
really
have their own requirements.
They don't care about user interface or whether you can deploy in 15 minutes, do they?
Look, they spend a lot of time in front of crappy software, so we're going to liberate them from that tyranny. But they do have their own requirements. They have manageability. They care about, you know, making sure the right people have access to the right data. And you know, there's a long list of things that they care about. And we have made those a priority. And then the third constituent to your question is the business folks, the digital business leaders that want to see how many widgets am I selling on my e-commerce site or
and what's they're stakeholders clearly in New Relic today. They're stakeholders.
Yeah,
right?
So our vision is we're the first best place to look to understand your digital business, whether you're a developer, operations, or a digital business leader.
It's
all coming from the New Relic platform.
Yeah.
And how do you think that's a big opportunity.
It's huge. And how do you market that? How do you communicate that message versus the message from 3 to 4 years ago?
Well, it's this conference. I mean, that's all I need to do. It's done. No. really, we think about, again, how does New Relic get discovered at an organic level?
Yeah.
So that rather than, how do people search for New Relic more? Rather than us blasting New Relic through the traditional marketing channels. It starts with an amazing product that people tell their friends about.
Yeah.
And it starts about communities of people that self-reference. And then that gets us into an account typically. And then what's the marketing and messaging plan once you're in the account? So typically account acquisition happens through the developer or the innovation engine in an enterprise that wants great stuff that works well, that's SaaS and that's easy to use and modern.
Yeah.
And then how do we message that to grow within that account is the nuance of how we go to market, right? Because you do need a slightly different message for different constituents, and they all are important.
CIO's office of GE is looking for different things.
They are. Yeah. Well, what's exciting to me is GE has publicly declared themselves a software company, so those really cool commercials about how, GE's a software company, right? So if you're transforming, and this is happening across the world, companies are becoming software companies, and they realize the old vendors, especially in systems management space, don't understand that motion. They don't understand agile. They don't understand fast iteration, customer centric.
They don't understand it, or they just don't want it, or they can't, or don't want to change.
Well, I don't think they have a culture of delivering on that. They have a culture.
I don't think anyone's stupid out there usually that has a real business.
No. That's fair to say. Maybe they understand the concepts, but they have decades of operating a different way.
They're not going to change.
And it's baked in their financial model, their compensation model, their product engineering discipline, across the company. So that's why we think we've got an opportunity.
Yeah. So on a related note, how have your views and what are your Zen learnings on competition through the different phases of New Relic or even before? Because you're in a competitive space, right? But I think in a segment of a very competitive space, you have a fairly strong market presence.
Yes.
Right? But not in every segment.
Right.
So, and how does that change over time as you get bigger? You have a lot of large numbers to start thinking about, right?
Sure. It has changed over time. Early on, we had very little to no competition in APM and SMB. That created, I'm from Canada. And I felt like our company kind of became just this nice Canadian company that everyone liked to work with.
Got it.
And then all of a sudden, as we grew, more and more folks coming up Sand Hill Road saying we're going to go straight at New Relic. We're going to out New Relic. And then, of course, as we move into these large IT budgets, there's a bunch of people saying that's my turf. They're going to get defensive about it and get really aggressive on us. And so we've had to learn to be a little less Canadian culturally. someone punches you 3 times in the face in the schoolyard, you got to at least defend yourself and maybe punch back.
I feel like Kumbaya ends around 10 million in revenue.
And so we have gone through that change over the last 3 to 6 months, to be candid with you, culturally. Yeah. And it's great. It helps us mature as a company. I mean, we can't lose sight of the fact that our mission is to deliver on that vision I just described, and to do it for hundreds of thousands of users today. But there are obstacles to achieving that mission, and those obstacles involve, we think competitors with products that have a poor user experience, harder to manage, harder to use, and really do our customers a disservice, so it's in their interest for them to see the light that is New Relic.
Yeah. So in a raise, though, because I know you've, so in terms of raising tons of capital and competition, the more, we sometimes wonder what's going on in the market sometimes.
Yeah.
New Relic, I think, is a medium, I think you raise two small, by 2015 standards, relatively small rounds, right? Maybe a third and then IPO'd, something like that, right?
Yeah.
And when your competitor raises 100 million or 80 million or 190 million, what's your advice to grok that and think about it? Because it is real money, right?
Yeah.
And it enables folks to do things that aren't particularly profitable, right? And you're in Kumbaya land. I love Canada, right? Yeah. And why can't we all be friends? And then you wake up and you read TechCrunch and they raised 100 million, right? What's your advice or Zen learnings there?
So first of all, let me take a little history on the funding of the company. Our Series A was $3.5 million.
Yeah.
Our Series B was $6 million. We raised small rounds by design.
Yeah.
Because small rounds early on are a forcing function to help you really think hard about your model and the scalability of your company. And to be wise with your investment dollars and focus is so important early on. So,
and you clearly could have raised much more after Wiley. You could have got raised as much as you wanted.
Yeah, we had offers to raise a lot more money, and we felt like, look, capital is, there are times when you need capital to solve problems, there are times when you need really smart thinking to solve problems on a smaller
yep.
scale. And especially early on, I feel like companies overcapitalize. So we didn't want to do that. I think a lot of our competitors did.
Yeah.
Because you can kind of, you can manufacture growth with spending. Certainly we invest for growth. But as I say, we're not growth at all costs. So early on when we felt like we had a really solid model, like for example, last quarter we announced a net expansion rate of 129%. That means that if we don't add another customer to the company today, net of churn, our business will grow 29% over the next year.
Helps with the nuclear winter strategy too,
doesn't it? It certainly does, right? and so, you know, that's part of the model we've built. And so, if you kind of think about how you structure that, capital. I love exactly where we are in this competitive market, and this challenging public market situation, because I feel like overcapitalized competitors have a lot of hard work to do to figure out how they're going to rationalize their businesses in this kind of market.
Yeah.
I don't think we have that problem.
Yeah. I think that, I agree. I think what, there are two, in competitive landscape, there's two ways to take advantage of being overcapitalized. One is just throw money at growth,
yep.
right? Which, is, assuming you have an engine, sort of works, right? You mm-hmm. can have a bad CAC, and you can force yourself in.
Right.
But the other thing you can do with a lot of money is you can play dominant strategy, and you can say, you know what? I can't really compete in New Relic space profitably, right? I'm gonna lose, but I'm gonna do it anyway. I'm gonna put $10 million,
yeah.
And you know what? I'll never make money competing with new, and I don't care because I can play dominant, and that is confusing for founders.
Well, that's why I say this is a wonderful time because this is a wonderful time because that might have worked 2 years ago when multiples were through the roof.
Yeah, that's an advantage is play dominant.
Not
right?
You know, you're not going to be able to fund a money losing company with that strategy in today's investor environment, nor should you. So again, if you've got the time frame we have. The time horizon we have in our decision making, focus on building awesome stuff that our customers love.
Yeah.
Those will be temporary distractions.
For sure. So let's talk a little bit about as you get bigger, how the product grows, right? With Jay Delasting, we talked about four products, which to me still boggles my mind. It's a lot to manage.
Yeah.
I think you've still got one-ish product, but really
oh, no.
a family underneath one-ish product, right? Your work, I don't even know what the acronym today. New Relic isn't APM anymore, right?
Software Analytics.
What is it? Sorry?
Software Analytics.
Software Analytics. Okay, well, that works too.
It certainly you could get does.
Just do your Series A again, just on that. So what are your learnings? How long do you stay focused? Do you let the market pull you? You didn't like that experience at Wiley, right?
Right, no, so.
But not everything.
Yeah, let me, yeah? This is a wonderful opportunity to clarify something. We have 5 SKUs, all organically built.
Yeah.
And they all work flawlessly together. So you may think of it as looking like one product because it's such a seamless integrated experience, which again is just unheard of in the systems management space where historically these companies have built their product portfolios through acquisition and they've never worked well together.
Yeah.
So we've done the opposite. Half our business come from multi-product customers. What have we said publicly? We've said things like, I think, geez, I'm gonna get myself in trouble on what we said publicly, but it's
just do rough and tough.
you know, north of 20% of bookings we've seen in a given quarter have been non-APM, and so our other products, and this is part of our strategy, is this platform where APM monitors the health of the application running on the server.
Yeah.
You want to see what's going on in the mobile device? That's a separate problem. You want to go see what's going on in the browser?
Yes.
You want to do synthetics? If you remember, like the Mercury business back in the day. So we have New Relic Synthetics, which allows people to actively monitor their application. Then, of course, New Relic Insights, which opens up this whole analytics opportunity to servicing the various needs of the business user. And so we now do 5 product deals routinely, and customers are buying us in on the solution. And that's a big part of our competitive strategy, is that it's not a kitchen sink strategy. It's that these things belong together and the whole problem needs to be solved.
Yes.
But that it can't be done through rolling up disparate products that don't really work together.
Yeah.
And so that's where I think having an R&D-centric culture, I describe New Relic as a product-first company, that works to our advantage over the long term.
And how do you, and as the product does, as you have the five SKUs, do you let the market pull you there? Because it still is a distracting. Each SKU is, it is distracting. And we'd all love, in a perfect world, to do one product, have no competition, right? And social network. You wouldn't like that, right?
I love building products. It's what
we love to keep building products, but building 50 is a lot harder than building 5.
No, I don't want 50. I want
some products may merge.
There's a bit of the market pulling, and then of course there's the whole. I mean, what's beautiful about the technology industry is sometimes there is this harebrained crazy idea where you try to define where the market will go.
For sure.
Wiley was that. Yeah. And then New Relic was that for, democratizing that category of software. And now, APM being something that's a little long in the tooth now as a 17-year-old category, software analytics was about servicing the needs of the business user. So there is a bit of that, innovation and that you can't find in a customer meeting or in a Gartner report or an IDC report. But then that has to be also a healthy balance of just listening to your customers, asking them what their problems are, and then solving them for them. A key part of what I think of a product strategy is, it obviously has to be something that we believe makes business sense. We can sell it, and we can offer it to, probably the same buyer or a similar buyer. But also has to have this unnatural advantage of leveraging what we already offer the customer. We can't just build it, in isolation of what the market wants. We also think of what are our unique skills and strengths that make what we can offer so differentiated that, again, it comes back to that whole, the way you described New Relic at the beginning. I think we generally have a really good brand with our customers for building stuff that kind of pops, that people like to use, and that has to be part of why we decide to build something.
Yeah. Now, one of my things I like to do, but to a fault, is oversimplify things to make it simple. So I tried to have a rule that 25% of development time was focused on stuff that I know we need to build, but I don't have customer demand today for, right? How do you think, going to that category of the future that you can see, right, but you don't have demand today, do you budget it? Is it at this scale? How do you think about that?
Yeah, I think it was a McKinsey report that kind of defined it in Horizon 1, Horizon 2, Horizon 3. I'm not sure if...
I got to read that one.
But basically the notion is your Horizon 1 product is your established product that has been paying the bills and is kind of the flagship of the business today. Horizon 2 is the newer stuff that's in the market that's growing faster, and Horizon 3 is almost speculative.
Horizon 3. So how much time should we spend there?
In a way, it's kind of reminiscent of my comment on capital. You don't need a lot of capital on Horizon 3, but you need to put really smart or really capable builders and innovators. There's a different skill set. Comfort with uncertainty, and ability to face the fear that what you're building may suck or may have no value, things like that. I face that fear continually when I create things.
Yeah, they can't lose their job.
Right. So I'm certainly not, the whole coding CEO thing is a bit of my, my persona, but I wouldn't want it to be interpreted that that's like, the innovation engine of the company in and of itself. I do it as a therapeutic thing for me. It helps me think and energizes me for coming back to the company and connects me with what we're building today and what the needs of our customers are. And sometimes I come out with ideas that actually help on Horizon 3.
Yeah.
But we have a Horizon 3 team. It's a small team. And then the trick, though, is, I think Jay spoke this a bit. You got to think about when you're building products also, who are the people that you have and can they build amazing things? So you don't want that Horizon 3 team to just hand it over the wall to Horizon 2 when it's done. They kind of need to migrate over because that ownership of the success, the product from the builder, that product needs to continue.
So you need to let the Horizon 3 folks own it in Horizon as it becomes Horizon 2 is the learning?
At least one or two engineering leaders that are kind of they're the founder of that idea.
Yeah.
And great products come when there feels like there's this ownership that this is your baby and that you want it to succeed. So, in the case of New Relic Insights, that was, for me, the idea hit me for the Insights database technology. December 29th, 2012. I was in Tahoe with my family, and my wife knows that when I get that idea, I get a little crazy, but like sometimes great things happen for the company. So she packed up my daughter, and they went back home.
Yeah.
And then I coded for 10 days in Tahoe. And I came out with a database, or at least the beginnings of a database. And then I stayed through with it through the first 6 months of the year. So I was, you know, I had a very strong president, kind of someone who's, you know, in some ways reminds me of Jay, who I said, look, I'm gonna be less present for a lot of the Horizon 2, Horizon 1, running the business, sales, that's all important stuff, and I'm not gonna disengage entirely, but for the next 6 months, I wanna make sure this thing becomes a product.
Yeah.
And so I'm gonna build the team around it, I'm gonna cordon them off from the whole, you know, keeping the company running so that it has enough focus and momentum to make it through to the market, and that's how it came out.
So on, just on a related, especially for founders here that don't have an engineering background, we'll all end up getting at least, even early, one or two just insane great engineers that are hackers that can go out and build you something in a week or a day that would take anyone else 90 days and a whole PRD to build, right? And they build amazing stuff for you. Is your advice to try and get them then to own the product as you truly put it into true production, right? Do you think that person can own it to the CIO of GE? Because you have more experience than me, but I found that a struggle to have her continue to own it as the product gets handed off to its sort of GE level.
Well, I think it needs to get to a certain level where it's probably past the first GA. But I think one of the great art and difficult part about managing builders of software, engineers in particular, is somehow trying to align where the company wants to go with what they desperately want to build. And they're rarely in perfect alignment. Yeah. So it's a bit of a, like, the last thing you want to do is tell them, don't do this thing you're very passionate about. Never do that. Do what I want you to build, right? Yeah. They'll leave the company or they'll grudgingly build something that doesn't wow the customer.
You somehow need to
attract them over to where you think the company needs their creative juices and kind of challenge them with, I wonder if it's even possible to solve this hard problem. Yeah, I don't think, do you think you could do that? Really? Why don't you give it a try? And then all of a sudden they come away with something magic.
Yeah, I really think for folks, I mean, this is one of the most important skills to learn as a CEO if you haven't done it, is how to make your best people do that.
Yeah.
Right? It's not easy. So.
But it's fun.
You're better at it than me, but it is fun. especially when the big customer asks for something that was already on your roadmap, but not for this week, and we have to build it tomorrow, and it's boring, and it's a lot of work.
And what if it's better than what the customer even imagined? That's when magic really happens.
That's the magic, right?
Yeah.
So I want to go, before we run out of time, I want to go back to the comment you made earlier about Peter Fenton telling you to talk to customers.
Yeah.
Right? So let's fast forward today.
Yeah.
And let's tie that into that 129% net negative churn number, which is magic. It's the magic to all of this, right? How
at
much
our
time
scale,
do you spend with customers now, and how has that changed over time?
Have a customer call this afternoon.
Yes.
I budget about 3 to 6 full days per quarter for that now.
Three to 6 days a quarter.
Yeah, you know, around that. I have a budget for investors, so many days per quarter.
Who gives you the quota? Is it a self quota or is your chief revenue
officer
doing it?
Every December, my ritual, my New Year's resolution ritual is how am I going to divide my time for the rest of the year and align it with the needs of the company.
So 3 to 6 days with customers.
That's where I'm at today. That'll change depending on the needs of the company.
Yeah. And do you get pulled into more deals now that you have bigger deals? I mean, you probably have to talk.
So Erica's going to be here, our head of enterprise.
we'll have her talk about it this
afternoon. She probably thinks not enough.
Not enough. Yeah.
But we want to be strategic with it.
Do you spend more time with customers than you did 3 or 4 years ago? As you've gone.
It's gone through ups and downs. I'd say a little bit more.
A little bit more.
I love spending time with customers. It's wonderful. It's a source of ideas and inspiration. It can be a big time investment, especially if there's travel involved.
Huge.
And I feel like, you know, if for those of you who are builders of software in the audience, like the 15-minute interruption for that one quick call can blow whatever creative zone you were
it's
in.
It's half a day. You lose
half
a day.
Yeah. So that's why I like to block times where they're just sacrosanct.
Yeah.
And so that maybe good creative things come out of it.
Well, let me ask a related question, and maybe Erica owns both, so we can find out this afternoon, but of those, is that 3 to 6 hours include existing customers and prospects? or is it just existing customers? And how do you balance your time?
Usually both. I mean, like a large portion of our business comes from upselling existing customers, yeah. You know, because...
So what's a better use of, today, with 129%, what's a better use of your time? Spending time with existing customers and making sure you kill it, or landing the next GE? What's a better use of your time today?
Look, it's not a good use of my time to bring me in to close a deal.
Yeah.
It is a good use of my time to align with leaders within customers and prospects to get them excited about the new Relic vision, and to make sure that they feel like they're partnering with the right company. We're building we're trying to build a very high quality that goes for a long period of time. When you're a GE, you're not looking for the feature that today. You're looking for a partner.
Yeah.
Hopefully that goes for a very long period of time. And I'm delighted to have those kinds of conversations.
Yeah, you need to meet with GE today as much as ever, don't you? Challenge me if I'm wrong, help educate me, but I think New Relic is a big company compared to a lot of peers here, but compared to GE, it's a little tiny company,
well, but,
right?
The part of scaling as a leader is it can't fall all on your shoulders. I mean, our president, Hillary Cobble McAdams, is incredibly gifted and talented, and she was president of sales at Salesforce.
So
her Rolodex is better than mine.
Scale. You get scale there is the key,
we got
right?
scale. So, like, I get brought in when it's about product and vision and technology strategy and values of the company.
Yeah.
And then Hillary can do just fine speaking to any CIO.
I got it, yeah. But that's magic in scaling, that she can do that for you, right? Not everyone has that asset.
That's the essence of building a great company, is finding amazing people to help you with the journey.
That's for sure. All right, Lew, this was amazing. Thank you very much. This was great.
All right, thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you all.